Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to welcome you all to the Halftime Talk feature interview. I'm delighted to be joined today by Ian Jones, Head of Knowledge, Insights and Research at the Energy Institute. Thanks so much for joining us today, Ian.
Hi, everyone, and thank you for having me. I appreciate you making the time.
Great to have you. And you're also, amongst other things, the lead author of the Energy Barometer, the UAE in Transition report and other reports. But I'll mention that one today in our interview because, you know, we are on the cusp today, literally, of the UAE hosting COP28. Now, of course, that's about many things and not just about the UAE and its transition plans. But maybe let's start with that and take that advantage of that in terms of, you know, what you see, and give us a few takeaways maybe from your report on how advanced the UAE is in transitioning its energy picture, if you like, as one of the players in this energy transition. And of course, that all plays into the COP28 objective, doesn't it?
Yeah, no, absolutely. Absolutely. And, we launched the Statistical Review of World Energy, which we actually took over from BP, who previously published it, back in June. And even back in June, we commented on the fact that the world was not on track to meet its 2050 net zero targets, with greenhouse gas emissions growing nearly 1% in 2022. And this was actually despite a record year of growth for renewables. And, you know, this statement was actually confirmed quite recently with the United Nations' own global stocktake that was recently published in September. So these concerns were also reflected in the findings of our recent UAE Energy Barometer survey, which we conducted on our membership across the region and other professionals working across the energy sector in the UAE. And they all confirmed that they expect the region to be adversely affected by climate change by 2050. So clearly, at a global level, there's an expectation that the focus of COP28 must be to get the energy transition back on track. And to achieve this, it was interesting that the respondents to our UAE survey were very clear that under its presidency of COP28, the UAE must proactively push on multiple fronts. And these included strengthening existing country commitments. People spoke very powerfully about increasing the deployment of renewables, about the need to reform and reinforce climate financing, and certainly a hope that we can broker agreements to phase out coal.
Yeah, and I mean, you mentioned coal and finance. Let's talk a bit about just that finance sort of gap, if you like, as well, Ian, because we had an interview earlier this week also with the S&P Commodity Insights chairman and president about sort of the annual need of what needs to go into financing the transition globally, and that we're currently on a trajectory of only having half of that funding put through on an annual basis. But another big sticking point has been obviously financing the developing world and what it needs to do. And how realistic do you think that is for those kind of economies to transition, if you like, at this point in time from an energy point of view? Is that a realistic expectation?
I think it is, but we shouldn't really focus on individual regions, I don't think. So the reality is that climate change is a universal problem, and therefore it requires universal action to be taken. And again, you know, this year's statistical review demonstrated that despite record levels of investment in renewables in 2022, global fossil fuel consumption and emissions continue to go up. And I honestly think that until we get to a point where the annual additions of clean energy start to exceed the annual increases in demand growth, then it's going to be really, really difficult to see fossil fuels losing their 80% plus grip on the world's energy mix. And, you know, we speak a lot about financing and funding. You know, we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that it's not just about funding large capital investments. I think that by adjusting their behaviours and attitudes to energy, end users have a significant role to play as well, particularly in terms of avoiding, unnecessary energy consumption through pretty simple actions such as lowering heating or raising cooling levels in their homes, turning off lights when leaving the room, etc., or installing, effective insulation. And I think equally important are the choices that we all make in terms of the technologies that we buy, such as smart and efficient appliances, hybrid and fully electric cars, etc. Perhaps even the food that we eat. And I'm not suggesting here we will move to sort of plant-based diets, but simply sort of favouring local supplies, etc. There are all very, very simple actions that we can all take to reduce our energy and carbon footprints.
Absolutely. I mean, and of course, one big consumer of oil and gas is India. Just to bring that up, because it's obviously heavily also reliant on, for example, oil imports. But it also produces coal and imports coal. And, it says for its energy security reasons, it just can't stop doing that, until it sort of makes more progress on its transition. Simply, and so just to ask you a bit about this topic of energy security that we have seen sort of heightened in the last year or two, Russia-Ukraine war, cut off of gas supplies from Russia, redirection of trade flows there for its oil. Now we have tension in the Middle East, which could lead to a disruption. Do you think that sort of energy security coming to the forefront has in any way dislodged the transition momentum?
Yes. So one of the elements that the statistical review covers is international trade in oil, gas, and coal. And certainly 2022 was an interesting year. And the results from the statistical review clearly highlighted that just as the world was seeming to return to business as usual following the COVID-19 pandemic, the conflict in Ukraine certainly changed our assumptions around energy supply and demand fundamentals around the world. And it's true that whilst international markets work to maintain secure supplies of energy, it was at the expense of significant price and cost of living stress across many economies, certainly as they scrambled to source energy. And this we actually saw put greater pressure across all three elements of the triple crisis. And the Energy Institute speaks very powerfully about this in terms of the impact not just on energy security, but energy costs and the energy transition itself. You mentioned earlier our UAE barometer survey that we released recently. And the results there certainly indicated that in that region, the respondents were calling for greater action on investment in carbon capture and storage, a stronger focus on reducing methane emissions and natural gas flaring, and a huge opportunity to make improvements in energy efficiency. So when we look at the results from that survey, the lead indicators to me suggest that sustainability and affordability are still very much at the forefront of people's minds in the Gulf region.
Absolutely. This sort of trilemma that everyone is now sort of refocusing on, as opposed to only transition or only phasing out. It's about this combined, I suppose, approach. You mentioned CCUS, methane efficiency as a three sort of maybe low hanging fruits. I mean, CCUS, not so much. That still needs a lot of investment. But methane is a big one that, a lot of people we've talked to in the last couple of weeks as COP28 approaches is, people are saying that is a no-brainer for the energy industry. It must come out of this meeting declaring some commitment to that, because it can be done. Yes, it needs a bit of finance and resource, but do you think, I mean, in terms of your expectations for COP28 generally, Ian, what do you think concrete-wise we will come out with this time that we didn't see the last COP or two?
I think definitely everybody recognises, and the numbers back this up, the global stock take backs this up, that the energy transition is not on target. I think the work of the UAE in its COP28 presidency this year is about reaffirming the commitments and making the commitments stronger. And getting the whole transition back on track, and ideally ahead of schedule.
Okay, but on the CCUS front, just to take one of those elements, that, you know, there is obviously, there's a lot of, I mean, the UAE has made a lot of investment towards that, but do you think the industry in general is taking that sort of solution seriously enough and putting enough money towards it? We need to still put a lot of money towards scaling that up, but it is, again, one of those technologies there. We just need to kind of beef up the scale. Putting the UAE aside, do you think that we're seeing enough sort of attention on that solution?
I think there's, in terms of CCUS, I think the progress that we've seen around the world in carbon capture and storage has been disappointing. It was interesting when we look at the energy barometer results, the respondents from the UAE, they do see a significant opportunity for an oil and gas producing country like the UAE to not just transition its energy system, but also to transition its economy. And there's significant opportunities in clean fuels. And this works at two levels, I think. So the respondents talk very strongly about opportunities in blue and green hydrogen. So starting to drive and be a key supplier to the hydrogen economy. There's also opportunities, as you mentioned, in CCUS around synthetic fuels. So you can take, if you're capturing the carbon, streaming the carbon, you can be combining that with hydrogen to produce synthetic methane. So there's opportunities on two fronts, I think, to introduce bridges to move away from dependency on fossil fuels. And I think certainly through the synthetic methane route, you're starting to build that infrastructure where you're positioning for a future hydrogen economy.
And I mean, in terms of the UAE positioning itself as a hydrogen hub, let's say, again, there's been two points of view on that, and that it can convert that into exportable products, which seems to be the more viable route that people are talking about, or it has to guarantee some kind of national off-taker business, right? And that is a big question mark, isn't it, for hydrogen in general. The investment that has to go in has to know that it's got the off-taker for the hard-to-abate industries. Do you think we'll see progress on that front in terms of that commitment to buy that?
For me, it has very strong parallels to the international LNG market. So for many years, LNG trains were developed based on guaranteed offtake and demand. So what you saw was a lot of development where the LNG facilities would be developed and demand was guaranteed through certainly a lot of the oil majors investing in gas-fired power plants. And then over time, as confidence built that the demand would be there, then you started to see the spot markets open up. And I do see similar parallels to hydrogen, that having the guaranteed offtake will be the initial stimulus. And over time, as people get confident in demand and in the security of supplies, that you will start to move to more liberalized global spot markets. A lot of talk we hear around hydrogen, though, is whether it will truly become a globally traded commodity like oil and gas and coal has become, or whether it will be limited to more local regional markets in use.
Okay, and let's talk about markets then, and talk about the carbon market while we're on the topic. Ian, again, maybe not your specialty, but let's talk about the progress on that front, that you know, we need to have a credible carbon market, don't we, for, you know, to sort of, I suppose, go back, if you work backwards, for everyone to sort of buy in to lowering their carbon. What sticking points do you see around formulating or expanding the carbon markets that we already have? Carbon trading.
I think so there's two elements to this in terms of price and externalities into how we use energy. And there are two approaches. There's the taxation process. And there's, as we see in Europe, where they've adopted the carbon cap and trade approach using the European Emissions Trading Scheme. Experience suggests that if you tax a commodity that has a very inelastic demand, then you don't really impact usage. So the classic example is smoking and alcohol. So if you try to tax people away from consuming fossil fuels, then that process that is unlikely to be successful. So the cap and trade system tends to be the more successful route to reducing CO2 emissions. And then there's another element as well, which is, you know, on the back of COVID-19 and the Ukraine crisis and now events unfolding in the Middle East, you know, there has been a cost of living crisis. And the question mark really, and I think this is a key element of the energy transition, which is, you know, it's not just about transforming and tackling climate change, but it's also about affordability and universal access to energy. And, you know, with the cost of living crisis that's sort of still evident across the world, then the challenge in terms of penalizing people further through pricing those externalities into the energies they use puts even more pressure on household incomes, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, of course, and that's the cost of living crisis. And you've got the Western one, and you've got, of course, the challenges of the developing world and their basic access to affordable energy, etc. Ian, let's talk a bit about renewable energy and sort of, I suppose we've seen, again, the UAE make great strides on the solar front. You've got, of course, the wind energy, which has made progress in other parts of the world. But do you think that oil and gas companies in particular are committing enough sort of going into, of their funds, if you like, into renewable investment? Do they need to be doing that? Would you think they should be? Or should it be newer companies who have the specialty in that technology pursuing that, if you like, agenda? What do you think would be the right balance there going forward?
I think we have to recognize that the oil and gas and power industries are fundamentally different. And it is an old cliche to, you know, expecting an oil and gas company to turn is like trying to turn a large oil tanker.
Yeah.
It will take time, particularly in terms of core competencies. So the skill sets required, the understanding of markets for power are different to oil and gas. I know we think about them in the same sphere of energy, but it is a capability. And the power utilities have decades of experience of not just building and operating power stations, but understanding grid networks and understanding their customer base. It simply will take time for oil and gas companies to move into that space, to build that same level of expertise and understanding. And it's like we've spoken already about the hydrogen economy. One of the benefits, or the potential benefits of that, is that you can get to repurpose existing infrastructure. So unbundling large capital infrastructure ahead of its useful time, it is an immense cost. And those oil and gas companies have sunk billions into developing oil and gas infrastructure that, you know, quite frankly, that they're not going to throw away overnight. So we need to help them. We need to help them transition, and everyone needs to be supported of this. And I fundamentally believe it will happen. It will happen over time.
Yeah, repurposing all that, as you said, all that infrastructure and the skill sets that could operate that as well, sort of transferring those, if you like. You talked about, let's talk about electricity, just in terms of the grid, just from a regional point of view, Ian, you know, in terms of power markets here in the Gulf and the attempts to think about unifying grid systems, etc., there's been a bit of progress there. Do you think that is a logical logical thing to pursue, or should it be each nation for itself, if you like?
No, absolutely. That was actually one of the questions that we posed in our UAE Energy Barometer survey, which was kind of sort of the values on one thing that the region should be doing more strongly, and this concept of shared facilities across the region. Came out very powerfully as something that should be pursued more strongly. And this we see this play out across the world as well, that if you start to connect particularly power grids, then the sharing of assets, being able to optimize across demand loads across regions, you do see synergies, you do see benefits and economies of scale from doing that. And it's particularly so as you start to see more investment in a lot of the intermittent generation, such as renewable wind and solar, which can be unpredictable. I suspect the solar in the Middle East is a lot more predictable than it is here in the UK. But this does pose challenges to system operators for matching supply and demand constantly 24/7. And you do see that increased grid connectivity helps that process and helps to maintain stability in grid operations.
Ian, before we let you go, let's ask you what you think could be your black or grey swan, let's say, for next year. I mean, you know, obviously can't predict, that's the whole point, that they're black swans. But geopolitics we've got in the bag already. Anything else out there that you think could disrupt our path towards transition and sort of the predictability of the investment that's going into the sector, whether it's conventional or new energy?
The black swan event for 2024. Well, after all we've been through over the past years, I'm not even going to speculate. I'm just going to cross my fingers very tightly and hope that there isn't another one. I think in all seriousness though, I genuinely hope that not only can we get the energy transition back on track, that we can get it ahead of schedule, and I do feel that the work to do that starts here and now with COP28 and the UAE, because quite frankly, and this is my own personal fear, that if we don't, it's going to take probably an environmental black swan event, such as, I don't know, no ice forming at the North or South Pole across an entire year, etc. Something like that for us to actually wake up and start to take the action that we need to get the energy transition moving. And if it takes a black swan event like that, then I hate to say it, but it's probably too late.
Okay, and what about, how important, just one more question that's related to that, how important do you think it is that, you know, oil producers such as those here in the Gulf have, you know, reasonably high oil prices, i.e. revenue, the revenues and funds, therefore, to continue to invest in the transition? I mean, people are saying today oil at $80 is cheap, given inflationary surroundings, but is that an important target, do you think, for oil producers who are investing in the transition to continue to have, to realistically be able to fund what's needed in parallel in the transition?
I think there's a great opportunity here for the UAE in particular to set the template for how they transition their economies. I think we've reached a point where we understand that it's no longer a question of peak supply of oil and gas before 2050. Mm. It's a question of peak demand. And that's what I'm alluding to there, is the extent to which politicians will allow us to continue to use and burn fossil fuels. And clearly that's going to peak before 2050. And I think there's a consumer response in there as well, in the choices that people are making and insisting upon. Those oil and gas producers, countries, they have to rewire their own economies, and that has a cost associated with it. Providing those revenues, the profits from oil and gas activities, are being ploughed back into those activities, that are being invested heavily in clean technologies, and helping the rest of us transition as well, I think then that's acceptable.
Well, they're certainly doing that here in the UAE, that's for sure. Ian Jones, Head of Knowledge, Insights and Research at the Energy Institute, thanks so much for joining us today on Halftime Talk. It's been great to speak to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me.